Welcome to Opalesque Television. I'm in beautiful San Francisco. It's a fantastic day in the office of ValueAct together with Jeffrey Ubben. He is the founder and chief investment officer of ValueAct. And Jeff, I'm curious, how did you get started with value and activist investing?
So I entered the investment business in 1986 at Fidelity Investments as an analyst. I grew up in the business. My dad was a money manager in Chicago. And worked my way through the analyst ranks and ended up running the value fund by 1990, which was a successful fund, which was growing every day as mutual funds did back then. And I ended up basically every day, instead of being able to stay concentrated in my best ideas, would have new money come in, which would dilute my fund, and I would end up with 120 in positions, and every time I would get it back down, the fund would grow and I would end up again with 120 positions. So I kind of said to myself, by the time I was 32, 33, what am I good at? How do I make money? And how do I position myself to kind of invest my money the way I can invest other people's money? And made the decision that I needed to get a smaller asset base so that I could, it wasn't always growing and I could stay concentrated in my best ideas. And I had a temperament that was probably longer term than a lot of people that manage money then and certainly now. So I came out to San Francisco to work with basically a merchant bank called Blum & Associates. And when I arrived, he had a small pool of investors that committed money to do even more concentrated than I thought was appropriate, 4 or 5 investments at a time. And Dick would serve on the boards of these companies and turn them around from the inside with a long-term time horizon. So we kind of married Dick's what he called strategic block investment approach, where you work closely with companies, public companies, more kind of distressed public companies, from inside the boardroom with my sourcing skills, which, you know, were extensive because I had been running a lot of money. And we ended up with a kind of a perfect balance, I think, where we owned 15 to 20 companies where we were very active inside the boardroom in a third of them, let's say. And the other two-thirds we were, you know, active from outside the boardroom. None of it was very much focused on the negative energy of active investing. It was pretty much as constructive as we possibly could be. In 1998, 1999, I think I left Fidelity in 94, 95. 1998, 1999, Dick and myself were successful in taking a public company private using the company's balance sheet to do it. And it's a company called Kinetic Concepts. For a mutual fund investor to kind of go cradle to grave and take a public company private was a great experience. You know, it's a different mentality. You're interfacing with banks and you're doing 70-page models and you're making decisions about very long-term product cycles. And then we did that a couple more times. We did also CB Richard Ellis, which we invested in 2000 and took private shortly thereafter. So all that was great. Dick committed to a model of private equity. So even though we were investing in public companies, he wanted to go raise 10-year money from pension plans and kind of move more toward a transaction-based business model where you actually take a lot of these companies private. I thought and was more comfortable investing, certainly at the time, in public companies. I kind of said to Dick, why go be involved in an auction when I can go buy that company in the public market at 4 or 5 times cash flow, and why not then sell it at 7 or 8 times cash flow to the private equity crowd? And private equity was just then exploding. It got even bigger than I would have ever thought. But it was, from my perspective, I was trying to play the other side of private equity. I would rather go in the market and buy and sell to them. And there's a cycle around private equity. It's about a 7-year cycle these days in terms of when they raise the money and when they have to, you know, get it to work so they can raise the next fund, right? So why not take advantage of that cycle and use them as default buyers to a certain extent? In the end, the beauty of active investing the way we do it is buy at a discount from an uninformed seller in the public market and then fix it, and then create a de facto control situation by being the largest owner in the boardroom, and then get a control premium at the exit.
Yeah, so I was just asking you, this is basically your model, how you pursue activist investing at the moment, correct?
Yes. Because of that background, and because of that, the experience set of being able to take companies private and then in understanding the private equity world as well as I did, because it's unusual to have private equity and public equity skills in the same person. Mm-hmm. The two worlds kind of operate, frankly, pretty independent of each other. That my strength was much more around governance investing rather than what is developed in the active world, kind of media-driven campaigns to try to affect change from the outside, right? So my approach has been much more around getting inside the boardroom in a constructive way, getting all the information to figure out what's really right for the business and for all shareholders. The problem is when you work from outside the company and you come up with an idea or an agenda, you just don't know what you don't know. I mean, when Carl Icahn approaches Fairmont Hotels and he buys it at 36 and he basically puts it in play and it trades at 43, he's done fine, right? 36 to 43 and 5 months worth of work is a great return. But investors like T. Rowe Price, who we work with constructively on a lot of things, they've owned this thing for 4 years at 36 and it's just about ready to take off. This is 2005, right? And so, from their perspective, the business, it's the wrong time to sell the company. But, management in some cases will say, well, shoot, we'll do that. That sounds good to us. We'll get much more of the equity in a private transaction. So actually, that deal went off at 43. It's just wrong. It's almost a form of greenmail, to be honest with you. And so, but if you're inside the boardroom and you see the trajectory and you're a big owner, the last thing you would do is give up the ups. I would say, no, we're not going to sell to Carl at 43. I don't need the quick hit. Let's continue to pursue our business plan. And the same thing happens on the other side, Mateus, where, you go after a company from the outside that's actually doing much worse than and you say, sell the company, and then get into this big shouting match, and the company's put up for sale, and it doesn't take, and then you have a busted auction and 6 to 12 months worth of unconstructive work and a management team and it's been discredited. That's not good for businesses either. So you would never put a company into play if it was performing in a down trajectory, just like you probably wouldn't sell a company that was, that had a lot of momentum, but you don't really know that it's, from the outside looking in, you don't necessarily know enough to know exactly what's good for the long-term shareholder.
So in the end, you want to stay outside the media for your work.
So correct? I actually think it's almost imperative to stay outside the media. That we've done one. So we've made 55 core investments over 10 years. We've had a ValueAct partner on half those companies' boards, 27 different boards. We've ended up selling. A lot of times when we go on the board and own 15% of the company, we pre-qualify our exit like a private equity firm. And we really want to understand that there are strategic buyers for the business. And clearly the private equity cycle works for us too, every 6 or 7 years. And we have a conversation with the management team and the board, are you guys vehemently opposed to selling this company at a good price? Sometimes they say yes, and so we move on. Most of the time they say no. We also try to make sure they have equity that makes them feel like and act like owners, right? So I think 18 of the 27 cases where we've been in the boardroom, we've sold the company. But these are, after 4 or 5, 6 years worth of work in some cases. The problem with proxy contests is, if you have to go there, A, management's very entrenched, and B, the board's very entrenched, right? And the first thing you have to do is start defending your strategy to the company and to the other investors. You're in a media campaign. And again, I don't know what I don't know, so I'm forced to state a position on their assets that requires me to understand the complexity of their business, but I haven't been inside the company. They could undermine me that way. And when I get into the boardroom finally, after yelling and screaming, I have an agenda. So there's no way the board welcomes you in the same way that you do, that they would if you asked to come on the board, you interviewed with the board members, they understood the role you would play, and then you constructively entered that way, right?
When you work with a company, how many of your team are involved with it? Just explain us, how does the whole process work?
So we've been around for 10 years and we have 6 investment partners. We've never lost an investment partner. The last investment partner we added was in 2003. And 4 of us really have been working together since day one. And all of these partners have board experience, public company board experience. It's not a skill set you can learn in business school, like financial analysis. You have to actually do it and understand really how you move a room, especially if there's only one of you in the room, for instance. Mm-hmm. So one of the franchise values to ValueAct today is we've made this investment in our people, and they have this skill set that is pretty unusual in the public market. We're much more like private equity, if you haven't figured it out, than your classic public market investor. We basically spend a year on a company before we get, quote unquote, fully invested. Mm-hmm. And every partner has a chance to touch every company and every investment opportunity because we spend that much time. And we don't wait a year to make an initial share purchase. You know, it's iterative. Yes. So we visit the company 2 or 3 times. We have the East Coast office do work on competitors. You know, we engage consultants to call companies, to call customers. We might buy some stock after the first 3 months. We ask them a little bit more about their business. We get to see a quarter or two, and is it happening like they said it would happen? You know, does the business act the way we think it should act based on the franchise value? We spend a lot of time around industry structure because, you know, if we're going to buy an underperformer, which by definition it has to be because we're value investors, we want it to be a concentrated industry structure so there's only 2 or 3 players. And so, you know, the customers don't want us to go away. And there's a public company that we're competing with that has a big stock price and a high margin to defend. And so it creates an umbrella for us to get a new management team in there perhaps and get it turned around. That all takes about a year. We kind of go public with our idea at 5% when we file a 13D. Mm-hmm. And we do that, you know, carefully because we kind of own it publicly. And then the big check for us is at 10% because if we're going over 10%, we acquire illiquidity through the affiliate status. Yes. in this country. And, you know, it's at that point typically where we approach the company and we say, look, we want to buy a lot more of your company. We've been doing a lot of work on this thing for 9 months. We've talked to your board members. Why don't you do the sort of work on us that we've done on you? Here's 10 CEOs and chairmen we've worked with. You know, at this time we're filing Hart-Scott-Rodino at this time because we're asking for a board seat essentially. And come back and tell us, you know, before we commit to 15 or 20% of your company, we want to know that you're okay with a shareholder in the boardroom. That was not such an easy conversation 5 years ago. The good thing about active investing is it's become a much easier conversation for probably the right reasons, some of the wrong reasons, because there's been a lot of negativity around some of these campaigns. Sometimes at this point they just want to, you know, get past that. Recently, over the last 3 or 4 years, when we've made a commitment to the business long term, we've become the biggest owner, we approach them this way, we've had great success in getting into the boardroom, you know, in a very constructive way.
So this is basically how activist investing has been developing, right? So it has become a positive force.